Thank you, Jeremy, for your very inspiring talk. I hope I will speak a bit slower, but that's also because I'm not a native speaker, so I need to speak a bit slower. It's here for me. So I will speak about a museum, which is now my new working place. I'm now the new program director and the deputy director of the Jewish Museum in Berlin since 9 months. So I'm very much a new kid on the block. Who of you have visited the museum? It's well known, isn't it? Yeah, it is, it is. Who of you have visited the museum more than once? Okay, already half of the hands. And we are here in an audience of, I would say, professional colleagues. It's a site, it's a touristic site. We can argue and talk long about the fact whether it's an authentic site or not. But it is a site which is visited by 700,000 visitors a year. But most of them come once. And that's a huge problem for the museum. Most of them come, which is a bit difficult because in the beginning of the museum, I was also working there, working on this permanent exhibition, which is now being refurbished. Most of the people come for the architecture. It's maybe the most interesting object there is. When people come to Berlin, Berliners take them to the museum because of the architecture. And we can relate to that. But it's, of course, for the museum difficult. We have 80% of tourists. And in this 80%, more than 40 are non-German tourists. And my Berlin visits are, for the permanent exhibition, 5% a year. Which is, if we have 700,000 visits a year, still quite a lot of visitors. But you can imagine that being the new program director, I'm thinking of how do I get visitors more than once to my museum? How can I be a place more than related to a place of remembrance, architecture, dealing with this specific period in time? And how do I get visitors, especially Berliners, that come to other programs, like, for example, temporary exhibitions. And that's difficult. But difficulties are always, of course, also a huge challenge. For me, working at such a touristic site is relatively new. I myself come from a professional context of community museums. Community museums, neighborhood museums, city museums. And in these museums, also ethnology museums, there's a whole discourse about relevancy, about participatory strategies, about maybe less counting numbers, but more counting output. But how do you measure that? Every day I get an email with the visiting numbers, and every day I think, fuck, should not say that out loud. I don't want to hear the visit all on tape. I don't want to read the visitor numbers. I want to read more about the value that we are having. And of course, we have the largest educational department in Europe. In the museum field, and we have a beautiful, for example, digital and publishing department that Mirjam Wenzel developed very strongly. So there is more that contribute to value, but it is a problem. So my professional backbone, very strongly, comes from ideas thinking about social inclusion. What does it mean to be an inclusive museum? What does it mean to be a Jewish museum that deals with inclusiveness, although you need to go through all these gates before you enter my museum? And not Long ago, I spoke to a Roma woman, and we have Roma and Sinti table round discussions in a sort of secure place where people from that community can talk with each other. And of course, they had to go through this entrance security situation as well. And then afterwards, she told me, and I never thought about that, that it didn't feel like we were protecting her of something, but that she felt that she was controlled and that we were sort of protecting ourselves from people like her, being Roma and Sinti. Because that is, of course, always this paradigm that she has in her head. So I'm working a lot on that in my thinking. Like, how can I be an inclusive museum and being this Jewish museum? How can I be a museum that is part of a process as an agent of social generation? How can I be a vehicle of broad social change? And how can I become even an activist space? Being more and more an activist political space is something that in my Dutch context, or also in Great Britain, is very much, I would say, majority museum culture, but in Germany, that's still so not, is still not so developed yet. And I would like to make a contribution to that as well. Of course, in my museum. And what I like is this definition of the socially purposeful museum. And this is what I want the Jewish Museum to be like in, say, 5 years. That we are dynamic, that we are vital, that we have rich relationships with diverse audiences, participatory and co-creative practice, and that we are part of everyday people's everyday life. Foster progressive social values, site of dialogue and debate, the contact zone, we will talk about that later. And we work collaboratively in a network with institutions, also beyond the museum and even cultural sector. And why do we do that? Because we want to be more vibrant and inclusive and more just societies. And I want to make a contribution to that with my Jewish museum. And I think being a Jewish museum in Berlin, Germany, it makes sense to be a more socially purposeful museum. So this is sort of my professional backbone that I came with in my professional backpack to Berlin. And of course, I've been looking at the direct neighborhood of the museum. What is the direct neighborhood of the Jewish Museum in Berlin? Kreuzberg. And what is Kreuzberg? Culturally diverse. It's culturally diverse with very interesting, but also maybe economic difficult people in difficult economic positions. Large Turkish community, large Muslim community, and for my feeling, this museum has been put as a sort of tanker 2001 in this setting. It has, of course, a pre-history why this museum is there, but it feels as if the museum didn't really get into a dialogue with the direct local context, which, coming from the professional context, I just described, is very important for my own professional self-definition. And I think it's also important for us to be more in our local Berlin, local Berlin context, because I want more than 5% of visitors coming to my museum. And not only the tourists that come to the museum because it's in their guidebook and they know that and have heard that the architecture is so interesting. Or that we are a place to visit because we are a Holocaust remembrance site. Which we are in a certain way, at least people perceive us as such, but we of course aren't. So one of the things that we like to do in the museum is work more collaboratively with the local Kreuzberg context. And I will tell you a bit more afterwards, because this children museum fits in that development. And another context is that when the museum opened 17 years ago, the Jewish community in Berlin was, of course, so much different than it is now. There's now a second and third generation of Jews originally coming from the Soviet Union, and they, of course, tremendously developed the whole Jewish Berlin culture. You could even speak of a Jewish Renaissance and a living Jewish, a living Jewish culture in Berlin. And the same goes, of course, for the huge, large Israeli community in Berlin. Actually, the museum didn't really reached out to that particular communities, because it was not part of the Jewish community, and we are a state museum, and we are a museum for, and we don't want to be this source community museum. But the other hand, of course, time develops, and it's also interesting to be a place where those communities can meet, can be, and especially if you want to open yourself much more to the contemporary. So working and being much more in the contemporary is opening yourself to a living Jewish culture, which is now happening in Berlin and in Germany in general. So local and the living. But this community museology and this tourism, it sort of didn't fit in my head, because there were so different poles of two sides of one medallion, and that's why I looked at tourism out of this slow tourism context. And what I found very inspirational was this slow movement. Slow movement comes from slow food. Italian comes from Italy, by the way. Slow movement came up in the 1980s. Slow food was the first. And it's all about sustainability, about the local, about being organic. What that means in a museum context is, of course, debatable, but it, at least it's not mass produced. So it has something to do with a unique thing. It can also be unique products that you sell in your store, or that you have in your restaurant. And whole, in the sense of not possessed. Maybe that's a sort of Rudolf Steiner kind of twitch to it. So slow food was the first one. You have to be aware that there's also this reactionary anti-modernist link to it, which might also be in a way anti-Semitic. So I'm aware of that. But the slow food movement, then in the 90s, slow cities. So how can urban development, urban regeneration be sustainable, say, no towards high, how do you call it? Development of inner cities, slow architecture, slow gardening, slow education. I think we had a very beautiful example of slow education by my previous speaker. And even, although he speaks very fast, the slow art movement. And the slow art movement developed in the Jewish Museum in New York, Jewish museums, where somebody was taken to the museum by his wife, and he noticed that people only stay and watched a picture for, say, 15 seconds. And we know out of visitor research that people stand in front of an object for less than 3 seconds. And shouldn't we have a slowness in museums, slow museums, slow tourism, the slow art movement, where we have different formats for people to enjoy art, to enjoy heritage, whether it's movable or non-movable. So this slow movement, I feel, is something that I can use in my Berlin context to have this critical museology coming from neighborhood museums and community museums on the one hand, and this touristic 700,000 people visiting me each year. So it's ego tourism, people call it as well. It's smaller scale, and it's very much also about economic development and human rights. Hey, then I'm coming back to my being a socially purposeful museum. And one of the things that we are and have been developing is on the other side of the museum is our academy building, or our Blumenthal building. And here, since 3 years, we have an academy program where we have a sort of academic offerings for people and artists or scholars in residence programs, where we discuss topics related to migration and diversity. So it's opening up this Jewish museum towards larger issues in contemporary German and European society, and of course the Muslim migration and very local context is important in that. But that is very much highbrow. Although when you come to such an academy program, you would see a lot of people wearing a headscarf. So there is a sort of new bourgeoisie coming, which is still sort of fitting in this bourgeoisie context, but is cultural diverse, hyper-cultural diverse, I would say. So that this museum, this Jewish museum, offers programs that is very interesting for a sort of larger, hyper-diverse audience. But we wanted to do something which has the same intercultural context, but gets more into dialogue with the local, or even more into dialogue in our local Kreuzberg context, and therefore the Children's Museum. And I have now talking about education till now, but everything I do, and I think everything what a museum does, it's all about education. Because for me, education is putting your visitors and the needs for your visitors central. It's not about the object, it's what you do with the object that makes it relevant. It's about that's sort of our the project that we work with. So a children's museum. We will tackle Noah's story on purpose, because Noah's story is, of course, a story that plays a huge role in the three Abrahamic religions. So it's opening the narrative for a larger audience. And one enormous important aspect of this Arche Noah story, or children's museums in general, was that we know that most people don't come to the museum with their young children, because the museum is related in the minds to Holocaust and difficulty, and especially for a non-Jewish audience, which is 90% or even more of our audience, something which is to do with guilt and feeling guilty. So that we will do when you are older. So we have a tremendous difficulty in getting families with young children. And we want families with young children. And we want to get into a dialogue with people, especially with younger people, when, yeah, and have a sort of first, not so difficult connection with what Judaism stands for. So that's why we chose Noah's Ark. And Noah's Ark will be in the building opposite the Jewish Museum, so in our academy building. And it will be a Mesopotamian Ark, so we won't stick to the Abrahamic religions, but we go even a layer back in time. We will start at the Mesopotamian times, but also the Abrahamic, so the Bible and the Quran stories, and also look at other flood narratives in other cultures and religions in the world as well. So it's opening the narrative by using the Noah story as a sort of starting point. And I think that's something that Jewish museums can and should develop, is that we use this Jewish reflection, starting point, and develop from there into other issues, other reflections. And not for nothing, this Jewish museum deals with issues relating to migration and diversity in contemporary Germany today. So this is the Ark, and I all invite you in 2 years' time in 2019, because then we are opening. And you could say, what is the Jewish aspect of it? What is so typically Jewish, apart that it's the Noah's story? And we haven't tackled one issue yet so thoroughly. It's about the intangible cultural heritage. So the intangible cultural Jewish heritage, it's all about tikkun olam, making this world a better place. And the tzedakah, so in the Ark, it's all about taking care of each other, which are fundamental Jewish values. And value thing is nowadays a huge thing in the museum scene, and everybody is rewriting their mission statement, and it's all about values. But what are our specific Jewish values as a Jewish museum? And there I think that tikkun olam is a beautiful value to start with in a Jewish museum, in a hyper diverse story, and opening up the story for people who are living in the vicinity of the museum and in the larger Berlin area. And I hope that my visitor numbers in 5 years from now look different, that I don't have 5% of Berliners visiting me, but that I have more visitors. And that I also have different visitors that come to the museum because they want something which is related to the slow tourism, to the local, to the authentic, to the sustainability. And for me, myself, the slow tourism is absolutely something which I found very inspirational, and I hope you find the time to do some Googling yourself, and maybe it's also inspirational for you. Thank you so much. Thank you.